Cece.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Cece, for the introduction. I'm going to walk around a little bit, and I have a number of things to cover with you this morning. I want to start by talking about the objectives that we're trying to cover here. We're going to do a little bit about the Affordable Care Act because it's the elephant in the room. It sets the funding for everyone as we think about what's available for innovation, what's available for new avenues. I'm also going to talk about the consumer and customer-centric focus because the health system of the future is going to be built much more around the individual and much less around those who provide care, those who ensure care. It's very much about the consumer. And we can all say, yes, we're all dedicated to the consumer, but I think everyone is going to be making change as we think about how do we put the consumer in the middle of the healthcare system. And then I think the other major change is around the reimbursement model itself. We all know that the fee-for-service model is perfectly built for volume, and that's what we get in our system today. And we really have to move to value reimbursement models. And there are as many definitions of how does that play out in the marketplace. So I'm going to give you a view of some of the things that we're doing in Florida to move that equation down the road. And hopefully, when I'm done, some of you will be mad at me. Some of you will think I've said some things that are on target. Some of you will say, wow, that is not at all what I thought I would hear from somebody running an insurance organization, and I'll be happy with that. We, in fact, are running what we call a revolution within our organization to be a health solutions company, insurance being a small part of what we do. So when we look at the Affordable Care Act, let me address as simplified as I can make it for a big, very complex bill, what I think is actually taking place in the market. So we said premium subsidies would be in place to drive costs down. Actually, it takes premiums down for those who receive it, but it does nothing to take cost out of the underlying system. So premium subsidies, very attractive part of putting exchanges in place. That's what draws people into the exchange in the first place. Then you have the cost-sharing subsidies that are in place, and what's commonly referred to as the three R's. It's really the way we look at the risk corridors, the reinsurance in the model. It's a way of saying to the insurers who now play in the exchanges, we're going to offset your risk because you had no idea what you were going to end up with in terms of your enrolled population when we move into the exchange. So this is a way of sort of balancing the marketplace as we first move into the exchange. So if a company enrolls a much higher than normal risk and another company's got a lower than normal risk, there's going to be a revenue exchange, if you will, to offset those who have taken on the greater risk. What we are looking for in the bill is to not have somebody trying to take just the healthy people out of the equation and leaving those who really needed to be served to fend for themselves. And then obviously competition, right? So if you have an open exchange and you've got a lot of people on that exchange and they have to fight for where their price point would be, that competition would then suppress premium. So those were the factors on the top of the bar, if you will, driving premium down. Unfortunately, and this is no matter where you stand politically, I will declare up front, I'm an independent, and I criticize both sides of the aisle liberally, and I'm also complimentary where I think something's been done well. So I believe we needed reform, absolutely. I believe that everyone in the United States should be covered. That should not be an element of how we're operating our system, because we have the false premise of somebody showing up at the health system needing care and they get care, and the fact that they don't have coverage means that we're shifting costs around artificially in the system. The things that are driving the bottom end of the equation, however, have overwhelmed the things on the top end of the equation. So we have new market rules like no pre-existing condition, which, by the way, is a factor in insurance that basically said if we're in a marketplace where not everyone needs to be covered, we need to have something to protect against that risk equation. As an insurer, we're happy to have that out of the marketplace, but everyone should be covered. And we didn't get there, not yet. And we have to continue to move that continuum. Age rating compression. If you live in Minnesota, and by the way, I used to be the CEO of Blue Cross in Minnesota for 3 years and had the opportunity to go to Florida. No insult to my friends from Minnesota, but I took that opportunity to go to Florida. And I'm now in the Florida Blue plan. The difference matters greatly by where your state was previously. In Minnesota, there was a three-tier rating system. And now the Affordable Care Act requires a three-tier rating system. This means by age. In Florida, we had a seven-tier rating system. Why do I describe that to you? Because in Florida, if we had a young male, we could charge $150 a month for them to get individual coverage. Post the Affordable Care Act, that same young male, because we took seven categories and shrunk them to three, their lowest possible premium is $290. Now, that's an unintended consequence of the law. If they're subsidized, maybe they don't feel that, but that's something that completely blinded in Washington, D.C. So as we try to bring some of that information back, it gets difficult because Washington was trying to solve for the whole country. So I'm just giving you a little bit of the lay of the land of some of the things that drive the economics in the health system, because this is important for what's left to spend on innovation and new things in the marketplace. Health insurance tax, our industry was hit with $68 billion of new tax. For me, $120 million this year, $180 million next year. My entire bottom line last year was $200, so the $180 million next year is tax that just can almost eliminate that. So what do? That gets passed on to customers, right? So there's another driver of expense in the system. And then essential health benefits were raised in the system. So you've got all of these cost increases driving the bottom line. So you have a lot of things here that offset the things that were supposed to drive cost down. And so we all have a challenge. So people ask me all the time, when are we going to make changes? Because obviously a law this side needs some adjustment. The fact of the matter is, this year, we've got midterm elections. Nothing happens up to midterm elections. Right after it, we have the 2016 presidential election. So I'll just share with you that I think the changes to the Affordable Care Act show up in 2017 after we get through all the political back and forth. I don't think that's necessarily good for customers or good for the system, but I think it's a political reality. So how do we think all the various parties are going to change? Let me give you three examples of parties that have to change in this new environment. Members, as we call them, patients, as a provider would call them, they are rapidly becoming more a consumer of healthcare services. They're armed with more information. They want more information. They want convenience. They're demanding more of a system. As the system asks them to pay more of the bill, they are getting much more vocal about what they expect, when they expect it, how it gets delivered to them. And I'm sure you feel this in your practices. Healthcare delivery, which frankly I would refer to as we had a system built on sickness. When you got ill, we then addressed you, has got to be health and healthcare. It's got to be much more preventive. It's got to be much more on the front end of the system. It has to be keeping people healthy in the first place. This is a major shift, as you know. This is a major shift in practice and emphasis, and a lot of different players have a stake in this health part of the equation. But certainly the system itself has to retool itself for that. And then health plans, as I mentioned to you earlier, looking at themselves and each one of them evaluating how they play in the equation. We moved our organization to talk about health solutions as our company, and how do we engage in all the various ways of partnering and bringing better health solutions to the marketplace. And I'm going to touch on that as we move through here. So when we look at integrated solutions, we look at partners. You heard a reference to us having about 7 million people that we touch in Florida. We've got about another 10 million that we touch around the country because we do services to make Medicare payments in one of our sub-business units. But we emphasize being an innovator and reaching out to create these healthier solutions in the marketplace. So we created for ourselves a new structure for our company. So our health insurance entity is one of four companies inside of GuideWell, which is actually our holding company, Florida Blue being the insurance entity. As you move across that chart, GuideWell Health is where we have two staff model HMOs. But we also bought a multi-specialty practice in Tampa about a year and a half ago. Why did we make that purchase? That multi-specialty practice came to us. This may be a little provocative in this room, but they said to us, we have three hospital systems bidding on us. Each one of them will demand that we admit more people than we think are necessary to be admitted. We'd like to be bought by a third party. And we got in the negotiations, and we bought this multi-specialty practice as a result. The hospitals came at us aggressively looking for new partnership arrangements now that we owned a big part of their referral practice. So it changed the dialogue in that marketplace significantly. We're investing in emergency medical, and we just announced a deal last week where a South American HMO coming to South Florida is building medical clinics in a partnership with us, serving folks who are first generation South Americans who live heavily in the Miami, Florida area. So we are looking at ways to be part of the health solution where it makes sense. Our diversified services piece is our Medicare payment. We're a private label payer of Medicare for the federal government, and we do that in 12 states. So a very different set of services across our enterprise. We've also piloted what we call retail centers. So think about this. Your view of an insurance company was this big building on an urban skyline. You never went in there. Only the employees went in there. They're very distant. And you called them, and maybe you didn't get just what you wanted on phone service. We said we're going to turn this on its head. We're going to put ourselves in front of our customers. We built 18 centers across Florida. Every person who gets service from us is within a half an hour of one of our retail centers. You go in a retail center, you can buy individual product, so it was perfect for the Affordable Care Act rolling out. But beyond that, you can walk up to the counter and have your claim resolved face-to-face and understand how it was adjudicated. You can walk up and have a care consultant, a nurse, on staff with us, do your health risk assessment, tailor a health and wellness program to you. We do flu shots. We do all kinds of seminars for seniors. Think about Florida's demographics. We've got a lot of seniors, and in fact, some people that can spend some time in our retail center. And they do, and they have lots of questions. Last February, the New York Times came and interviewed us because they were very interested in this model. They put us page one of the business section, and as they are interviewing me in the retail center, somebody walks in and says, I'd like to speak to Brad. And the interviewer from the New York Times spins around and says, wait a minute, did you just ask for someone by name? Yes, I come every month. Brad knows my family, knows the complexity of our situation, and I get personalized face-to-face service. So when we were opening one of these centers in Tallahassee, a reporter comes running at me and says, why would you spend any money on bricks and mortar? Everything can be done online. And my answer back was, why did Apple build Apple stores? It's about engagement. It's about personalizing what you do. It's about the complexity of our product and the cost. We believe we have to be face-to-face with our customer. You can do everything you can do at our center online. And in fact, we teach people to do that. How many people do you know that actually need a warm transfer before they're comfortable with the app, before they're comfortable with the next thing of technology coming their way? We teach people that every day. And so we gain people for the online experience, but we're also personally connecting to our customers at a time where complexity, confusion, and personal issues in the health space are more important than they've ever been. Our retail centers this year will see over 275,000 people face to face. These are people with the most important questions about their family experience. So we were building this in advance of the Affordable Care Act, knowing that individual consumer-centric healthcare was coming and we would be ready for it when it arrived, and we are. And so it's made a huge difference. On a single state basis, we enrolled more people than probably anybody else around the country in the Affordable Care Act. We enrolled 340,000 people in Florida alone through the Affordable Care Act. Everything that we do can be done online. We have all kinds of applications, as we show here. We build worksite clinics for some of our largest customers. We walk the talk. We have a clinic on our location. We have health club on our grounds. We have workout facilities for our employees. We have all kinds of active and wellness programs in our space. And then we demonstrate for our customers how we're acting and behaving ourselves, because we shouldn't be out marketing something we aren't living in our everyday lives. So the model is clearly shifting. The pay-for-performance move to value payment or fee-for-service to pay-for-performance is absolutely underway. When we look at the state of Florida, if I showed you this map 3 years ago when I moved to Florida, it would have been basically the map of Florida. Today, we have a dozen accountable care organizations. One of them is with a cancer facility, the Moffitt Cancer Facility in Tampa. Why? Because some of the things you heard this morning, we want to have the right quality incentives in that cancer model. We want to learn how to take care of cancer patients in a much more effective way. And we partnered with Moffitt to do that. We're not running away from cancer patients and oncology patients in our market. We're embracing how to learn, how to do it differently, how to create the right payment model to incent doing the right things at the right time for the people that we serve. So we have these 12 accountable care organizations. I should say that when I was in Minnesota, we started putting these kinds of deals together ahead of the federal government. One of the things we did when we built them is we talked to doctors, we talked to hospitals, we talked to our major customers, people like General Mills and 3M. And we created models that had 12 or 13 quality incentive measures. The federal government rolled out theirs with 64 quality measures. And when they had 64 quality measures, Hopkins, Cleveland Clinic, Mayo, and others all said, we're not playing. Too expensive, too bureaucratic. Trying to boil the ocean. We went from, we could expand the number of quality measures over time, but let's start with the ones that will make a difference and we can measure them, which is a really important thing, right? If you're trying to move the dial. So we've tried to build that kind of a concept into the way we think about how do we engage the people we partner with in our state. And that's why we've had some success. People told me that we wouldn't get ACOs done in Florida because Florida was different. We have 12 of them now. Where you see the red triangles is where we own physician practices in the state. It's a different model. We have staff models there. We have bundled payment arrangements, one of them with Mayo Clinic in Jacksonville. Patient-centered medical homes all over our state. What we know about healthcare is while there are things from guideline standpoint that you want to have consistency around, healthcare is still very local in the way it gets delivered. And so therefore the model is tailored to the community we're serving. The ethnicity, because there's some differences to how people in different ethnic groups want their care. It's very much a family event in South Florida. You build your clinics around serving that whole family. You look at what's the built infrastructure from a hospital, physician group? Are they small practices, large practices? You must tailor to your community. Very, very hard for Washington, D.C. to put a model together that works all over the United States. There must be flexibility for local communities to do what they need to do to deliver the best of quality care in their marketplace. So this was the tee up for, this is what the environment looks like. Now, how do you drive innovation when you have an environment that looks like that? We believe partnerships are the answer. So let me take you through a couple of our critical partners. Lake Nona is just outside of Orlando, Florida. On the Lake Nona campus, you have Sanford Burnham Medical Research that came from California, La Jolla, and built their research facility for the East Coast in Lake Nona. You have the new VA hospital built in Lake Nona. You have the University of Central Florida Med School, University of Florida Pharmacology School, Nemours Children's Hospital, all on a common campus, greenfield community, and now the housing's being built around it. The housing is being built smart housing. Before first brick was laid in this community, the idea was build a healthy community. Build a community built with that wellness orientation from day one. So the partners driving this are Johnson & Johnson's Wellness and Prevention, General Electric, Cisco, and Florida Blue. We're the four partners driving what's happening at Lake Nona. And so we're very, very interested. It's going to take time to really come away with the conclusions here, but this is something that we wanted to be involved in. HealthBox. HealthBox is entrepreneurs. We seeded seven entrepreneurs in Jacksonville, Florida. We just launched another six in Tampa. We'll be launching two more HealthBox equations in Orlando and in Miami. HealthBox is a partner to us. It's an accelerator for new innovation in the health space. So while some people may think an insurance company wants to keep the old rules, block the new, we're investing. So we give executive sponsors to the entrepreneurs. We give seed capital to them. We show them in front of investors who will invest in them. And the thing that's really the hook is we tell them, if you design something that works, we'll deploy it in Florida, and then we'll be your arm helping you deploy that across the country in other Blue Cross plans nationwide. A great opportunity for an entrepreneur. So we're saying to those who are looking at disruptive innovation, we embrace that and want to be investing and part of that as it moves forward. In Tampa, we just had the MetaFuture conference, visioning what health and healthcare could look like 10 years out. And we were the chief sponsor of that, working with lots of stakeholders across the full continuum of health and healthcare, thinking about how does the model change? What does genomics do in this equation? What do we do with technology? How do we take care of that next generation? If your kids are like mine, their expectation is going to be that their physician visit is on their smartphone, that they're going to talk to their doctor, look at their doctor, they're going to put their finger in a device that they can clip to their phone, and all of their baseline meds are going to be translated through that, and they're going to have a visit, and then they're going to pick up their pharmaceutical on the way home, and they will not be interrupted by having to do a medical visit. Think about that. It dramatically changes the system. It turns it on its head. But that's what consumerism is in large part. It's making it built around the consumer and not around somebody coming to an office, waiting a half an hour in the waiting room, going back into a clinical room, sitting another half an hour, waiting to be seen. That will not be tolerated going forward. We're talking about a system built around that consumer and their convenience. And so the way health and healthcare gets addressed in our country will be dramatically different. At Lake Nona, we created something that we are now building called the Imagination Center. We will be inviting stakeholders from across the continuum to come and solve some of the thorniest problems in health and healthcare. Issues like a shortage of primary care, and how do we address that? Issues like virtual care, and what are the rules and ground rules to virtual care? Those are the kinds of topics that we'll be bringing people from across the continuum to the Imagination Center to help build and design the future of health and health care. And I will be a little provocative that our goal is not a white paper. Our goal is not to be in a medical journal. Our goal is to design things that can be put into practice and put into practice as quickly as possible to help move the continuum on how we can create quality, efficient health and healthcare in our country. health box I've touched on. This is the accelerator. This is a program that really looks at how do we take entrepreneurs and advance what they're doing in the market. Some of the key emerging trends that we've been looking at. My team and I have taken the trip out to Silicon Valley on more than one occasion to talk to people creating the cutting edge. In fact, we had a conversation with the Illumina folks, found them very interesting. One of the interesting aspects is, I'm preaching to the choir, but it was just a short time ago that it was $100,000 to do the genomic mapping. Now it's $1,000. And we know what happened in the computer industry when costs dropped to where it was ubiquitous and it was more possible for people to have direct access. It is about the analytics. It is about useful information. We've heard a lot of the cautions here from these great presentations that have taken place this morning. We're interested. We're very interested in this space. We can't get ahead of that interest by putting something in the market that we don't know how it impacts the individual, that we don't know if the data analytics are sufficient for a good decision-making path, but we want to be party to that discussion. We aren't resisting that discussion, we're interested in that discussion. And so we're finding ways for us to be at the table to have some of those critical discussions. We're looking at the Internet of Things and virtualization and how do we play a role in this? Because these are things that are going to happen to you if you're not willing to engage them. So when we think about partnerships, we're thinking much more broadly than people have thought about partnerships in the past, and we are very interested in ways to move forward. We have a tremendous amount of data. What we found when we've sat down with our partners is health delivery systems say, we've got a tremendous wealth of data, and what they find out is they do for when the patient comes to them. But, you know, electronic medical records are only as good as if you can really capture the full view of the patient. What happens when they go to a pharmacy? Do you have that data? What happens when they travel out of the state or the area? Do you have that data? And what we find in the wealth of the partnerships we've created is that we've got a lot of that data. And when we put that data together with the delivery system and we trust each other, and there's the big word that everyone has to work on, because what has driven a lot of the problems of the past is a lack of trust. If you can reach agreements where you trust each other and share data, you now have very powerful 360-degree view of patient that allows you to make a much more informed decision around taking care of that patient, being proactive about their care, thinking about what's next. And so that's something we're very much interested in and very much committed to. Just a couple of the experiments that we have going on right now in Florida is we're looking at the sleep pod technology. 60 million Americans sleep deprived. Raise your hand if you're sleep deprived, okay. Some of you are honest, some of you are not sure you want to embarrass yourself. There's so many of us that are sleep deprived, and these sleep pods are a very interesting way of thinking about, do we have the chance to raise productivity and increase health through having these sleep pods deployed? We're looking at that. We're doing some pilots there. A remote health kiosk. Talk about people who are in remote locations or people who are in our retail centers. The opportunity to have a physician visit remotely in that kiosk while they're there is something we're looking at. And so a very interesting partnership with folks out of the University of Miami. And then this takes you back to Lake Nona, the interactive mirror. Literally in the smart homes, installing a mirror where in the start of your day, you get all of your health status information, you get reminders about your day. There's all different kinds of information that can be transmitted there right in the bathroom mirror as you start your day. So we're thinking about different ways to engage patients differently than they've been engaged before. Much of what we're doing is not just about having the right answer, it's about packaging the right answer in a way that it's easy for people to use, convenient, it engages them, it meets them where they are, and those are the critical things that move something from just being an interesting idea to being something that actually clicks in the imagination of an individual and creates a movement towards health, wellness, and changing one's lifestyle. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Pat. I have to tell everybody that I had the opportunity to visit one of your retail stores, and they're beautiful.
Thank you.
I mean, the spaces are just gorgeous with the natural light and the blonde wood, and there was kind of a recipe area, and I got my blood pressure checked, and so I can see some of your Floridians hanging out in those spaces.
Thank you. They've been very popular, and one of the things I'm very proud of is the architectural firm we did it with really was very thoughtful. And when we built one of our centers, we had a gentleman who was the chief advocate for people with disabilities in our state. And he came in the front door, didn't need any assistant to come in the front door. They opened on, on him rolling up. We had counter space that was at his level. He could navigate the entire store. And he gave us, you know, an A-plus rating for thinking about people with disabilities. And often we don't think about the fact that in our state, about 12% of our population is in that category.
Of course. It is interesting, though, and you touched on it about your point about having Apple stores, but I'd love to elaborate a little bit because there is another whole school of thought in healthcare which says we want to do it on our devices. We like that convenience. It's kind of like banking and whatnot. Mm-hmm. So from your perspective, I gather it's not an either or.
No, we are playing in all of those. So we've got everything you can do in our retail center you can do online with us. And so that both of those exist simultaneously. But it's been very interesting for us to see how many young people actually come into our centers. They have as many questions. They haven't really been thoughtful about their health and healthcare decisions. One of the things we did is we sort of went to school on the Massachusetts Exchange. Mm-hmm. And we looked there and we said, you know, it's very interesting. People go online, they look at what their choices are, and they don't finalize a decision. They go offline, then they want to talk to somebody. Mm-hmm. It's too personal, it's too expensive, it's very complex. And so we're creating an opportunity for people to talk to us, and word of mouth has been fabulous.
And it is still wise from a cost perspective for you? Because obviously those buildings and personnel cost a lot of money.
They do, but you know, we've differentiated ourselves in the marketplace. When we look at statistics inside our center that are very compelling, if you think about your health plan, most people rate their customer service somewhere between a 75% and an 80% score. Customer service face-to-face in our retail center scores 92%. Mm. Our care consultants who are meeting with patients and doing the health risk assessments, 97%. Our retention on customers has skyrocketed since making face-to-face available for people.
That's a smart observation, too, because obviously it's much easier and more cost-effective to hang on to a customer than to have to keep going and winning new ones.
No question about it.
Right. Let's talk a little bit about virtual care. You referred to mHealth, and you've got some interesting pilots. Let's say 5 years from now, how do you think that fits into the bigger picture?
Yeah, you know, I think that's going to be taking off significantly. And it's interesting to see how it plays out, right? So there's a variety of stakeholders that are nervous about it. So one of the five-year issues is that in this last session of the Florida legislature, the Florida Medical Association attempted to block virtual care by saying any virtual visit has to be as expensive as a visit in an office. Now, that wouldn't happen in any other industry, right? Technology is what's supposed to help us reduce cost. Right. So I think we're going to see a lot, and it didn't pass, obviously. I think we're going to see that a real wave of people moving more and more into virtual care, at-home care. Mm-hmm. I think those settings are much more comfortable for people and are much more appealing.
And is an important element then, because I was also going to add to the list, say, the retail settings. You can go to a big box store now or a pharmacy and get more of your health care. One of those companies even just rebranded themselves with a new name. So given all of that, is an important element going to be the interoperability of the records and the data?
Yeah, there's no question about that. I mean, one of the big challenges we have right now is the data is only as good as what system you're confined to. And with as much as people travel and in Florida, for instance, we have many, many people who spend half their year in Florida and half their year someplace else.
Right.
So if that data
sounds like my mother.
Yes. So if that data isn't interoperable, then you really have a limited view of that patient.
Good. Maybe a little bit tough question here from the audience, but
okay.
I'm going to toss it out to you here. Can you walk us through the process of obtaining prior authorization for a medically necessary genetic test? How hard is that at Florida Blue?
You know, I'd say today it's probably pretty challenging. I mean, you really have to make the case for how that's being used. But I think we're open to moving that continuum. And really the issue is going to be around how effective is the test, what's the track record, what's the data and evidence. With most things, you really have to make the evidence-based case around the use of a given test. And I think we heard it here this morning, mm-hmm. where there's a body of evidence around some of the amniocentesis testing and those kinds of things. But other areas of genetic testing are much more speculative. And so we need to build that body of evidence in order to influence that.
I was wondering if you were getting some sweaty palms this morning every time we started talking about all of these big, new, expensive tests, because you're the guy who they're going to ask to pay for them. But maybe to this audience, do you have some advice to them about working with health plans, I'm going to guess much earlier in the process, to have that kind of discussion and what you want from them?
Well, first of all, surprises are the things that really create a challenge anywhere in a process. So the earlier discussion actually is the best course. I actually was very encouraged by what I heard this morning, because what I heard from most of the presentations was a conservative view of, we can't just jump into this without knowing where it's going. It's not for every patient. We need to be really thoughtful about it. We know we need clinical evidence for results. So I was encouraged by the approach that I was hearing from the presentation. So I thought it was a very thoughtful approach. But I do think early dialogue is the way to start. I think collectively, we all need to be open to public-private partnerships around working with NIH, working with health plans, working with key employers, and really setting at a high level the macro studies in place that allow for a broad decision to be made around testing.
So I'm going to really put you on the spot here, because we opened this morning with a little bit of controversy around some drug pricing. And again, when you sit there and you're the one that's got to pay for these things,
yes.
it strikes me that you don't have a way to balance short-term cost, you're going to have to pay for the expensive drug this year, versus potentially long-term savings. A patient lives a lot longer, they have a productive life, because you can lose those members every year, right?
No, that is certainly one of the risk issues, is understanding what the continuum of the patient and how long you're going to have the patient. But let me take you to one of the hottest topics in my industry, and that's Sovaldi, right?
I'm glad you said it.
So, yeah, I mean, you set a pill price at $1,000, and you need 80 of the pills. So you're right away at an $80,000 spend. Now, it's an effective drug, so it does become a very interesting trade-off discussion. I happen to think it's way overpriced, mm-hmm. and that it could be priced much more conservatively and be doing the job that we all need it to do. And so there are a lot of issues here. The issues then become, how broadly will it be applied? Mm-hmm. And what are the parameters for being on a treatment of Sovaldi? Medicaid plans across the country, states are going to be in significant financial stress around paying for a drug at this price. So I think what's happened, and I've talked to some of my friends in the pharmaceutical industry, many of them will tell you offline that they feel like there's a bit of a black eye uh-huh. that has been delivered to them by the folks that are marketing Sovaldi, because, you know, they're getting what they can get instead of thinking about sort of the broader issues and the potential repercussions to their industry. So I think there's a serious dialogue going on right now with pharma, with regulators, with researchers to say, we really can't just have the next specialty drug just roll right through the same pathway as Sovaldi. It may be good for those who own the particular drug, but it's not good for the country. And we've got to have more rational policy than that.
Especially when you think about the fact that in 2013, I think about 70% of the FDA-approved drugs were specialty drugs.
Absolutely.
So it's really current. Another great one from the audience here. Maybe you can just for a quick moment talk to us a little bit more about what you're doing to promote prevention, wellness, and, you know, do you, as a health plan, like these little gizmos that I wear?
We do. We have many of them that we pilot, many of them that we work with our members to use, and so we're big in the...
Do you pay for them?
We pay for some of them, depending upon the arrangement we have with a given employer. And so there are some of those that are in our programs. We certainly are promoting health and wellness programs. Depending upon what an employer is purchasing for us, they have a variety of ways to interact with us. We try and get our employers to also tie into our retail centers. So there's an opportunity for people to come through the center and really get you know, some incentive around continuing to be on a health and wellness track.
One final crystal ball question for you. Historically, employer-based health insurance has been the bedrock of this country, 150 million Americans today. But we know that with these new public exchanges, and you said you had phenomenal enrollment the first year, also the emergence of private exchanges. Do you have a sense of if and when our country will move from that employer-based insurance model to wide open marketplace, we're all shopping on our own, maybe with a defined contribution?
You know, it's interesting. At the beginning of any movement, people think everything's going that way overnight. And a caution I'd throw into this is it really depends on whether the public exchange migrates to become a high-risk exchange. If it does...
You think it is?
Well, it could. And so it's a concern. And I think some employers are concerned about that. Because moving your employees into a public exchange, if it's not the best thing for your employees, leads to productivity concerns and other kinds of issues. So there are a fair number of employers that are kind of waiting to see how this shakes out. Certainly the web page at last October 1 didn't get people excited about putting their employees there.
Right.
Think of all the productivity drop-off they would have had if all the employers
all
were
day
into
long.
October 1. Right?
Right.
So I think that there's some let's see how this works issue that's going on. So there's an element of that. I would say the big issue I have is that employers have a stake in the health and wellness environment. And we all spend so much time at our employers. I think it would be a shame for the employer to have no interest in that. Mm-hmm. Because there are many, many programs right now to create a healthy environment, create a wellness environment at work. And if the employer has less of a stake in that, I'd hate to see that revert back because I think that ultimately doesn't add to the equation.